I'm back.
John, nice to meet you, man.
Can't stop me now.
Welcome to episode 5 of Behind the Mask. I'm John Galante, and I'm very, very happy to have Richard Glazer back from your very brief hiatus. We have some real talent on the show today, and all layered up, so you're not cold. I like that.
It was very nice at the meeting that we had this past Tuesday night at Camden Catholic High School, our annual meeting, which was very well attended. And it felt very good when a lot of the our fellow umpires came up to me during the course of the meeting and said that they were glad to hear that I was back, and they were looking forward to seeing us together on episode 5, that they missed me on episode 4. I said, well, that's very nice of you to say. I appreciate it. And some of them said, you're a real fan favorite. And
you know, you need talent to win. If I'm Michael Jordan, you're Scottie Pippen. You know what I mean? And we weren't dealing with that kind of talent last week. I was trying to carry the load myself. You know, some would say I did a decent job with it, but you know, I don't want to carry it myself. It's a team effort.
Right. Scottie Pippen still made the Hall of Fame.
Right. Hopefully you do as well.
We've had a pretty busy week. Tuesday night, we had our annual meeting, which was held at the Camden Catholic High School. A very, very big turnout, especially.
It was an extraordinary turnout, our largest turnout in the history of the organization, mm-hmm. as far as our annual meeting. And I'm not one who's normally lost for words, but just getting in front of the room, we start promptly at 7 o'clock, just standing up there, seeing the wall-to-wall quality people and umpires that we had in the building. Sort of, I had to take a step back and have a flashback to where we started with this thing, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah, you look back when we one of the very first meetings we had, an annual meeting, drew 12 people.
Yeah, 12 people, fold out chairs in a baseball facility.
So I mean, we had a full house, and you know, we were also blessed to have some VIPs.
We did. Bob Barth, Colleen Barth, Gary Wilson, Lou Marshall, and they all had respective awards given out to the Umpire of the Year for their organizations that they selected. And I think it's really, really a great thing to have people of that caliber from organizations of that caliber choose and recognize umpires for the great service that they do. So congratulations to all the umpires that won those awards.
Definitely. There was also a very touching moment when Darlene Hoffman, the wife of Brian Hoffman, who was one of our initial members.
Charter member,
and a very great friend of yours. And, you know, I know the influence that he had. And one of the awards that were given out was the Brian Hoffman Award, which was presented to Mark Rowan, well-deserving of the award. But I was especially impressed with Darlene Hoffman's a presentation and her flashback, her memories of her husband, Brian. She did a wonderful job in speaking about Brian.
I told her there, she knocked that out of the park for the amount of emotions flowing through the room. I thought you did an exceptional job.
Right.
It was tough for me to get through my you know, speaking portion of it, but seeing her you know, battle through it and get through it was as emotional or more emotional for me to watch her. You know, remember the passion her husband had for not only umpiring, but for life in general.
He was a terrific guy. I remember I had the pleasure of working with him several times. And at that point, you know, he was beginning to struggle physically. And, you know, I could sense that his health was ailing. But nevertheless, he was working as hard as he could, like he always did. And when I listened to Darlene speak, it was reminding me of the times that I was with him. He was a wonderful guy, very hard worker. He was very helpful to me and to a lot of the guys who were just coming into the business.
Yeah, I can't help but think of what we would be now if he never got into the mix. I'm not sure we would have. We would still be in existence.
Certainly, Brian would have been extremely impressed with the turnout, and the turnout is obviously a credit to having Brian as one of our charter members, and I'm sure everybody's going to remember him, especially the people who were there when Brian was part of our group. But we try to bounce back after a very touching, emotional presentation by Darlene Hoffman. And when you got up to speak, I know you were still reacting to her presentation, but you were very impressive in your coverage of a lot of different issues. Why don't you just slowly walk us through some of the issues?
Yeah, I appreciate that. We're very fortunate to have a lot of quality presenters as well, in addition to me. We had John Harrington, who came out and did a presentation on game management. His resume is extensive, as you know. But speaking of game management, that seems to be the topic that I keep coming back to year in and year out. This would be year three in a row where I think that is the main topic of our annual meeting, because I think we're doing a pretty good job ball strike out mm-hmm. safe type of instruction and mechanics work. The thing that's going to set us apart and keep us as the premier umpiring organization in the region is the way we handle difficult situations and coaches. And I think that's the most difficult thing to teach. I think that's the most difficult thing for some guys to grasp. Mm-hmm. And the more we pound it home in situations where we have everybody in the same room, I think the better off we'll be. So I really like to try to use our resources to keep pounding away at this game management issue until mm-hmm. we make some headway. And we have made headway, but we're nowhere near where we need to be or where I'd be satisfied with us being. So John Harrington covered that extensively. Chris Lozzi touched on it. Jerry Wilgus did a nice brief presentation on the wedge theory mm-hmm. and how to get into position for tag plays, not only at the plate but on other bases, and sort of seeing the relationship between where the tag is applied and the runner mm-hmm. and having that all open up to you. So we went through a lot of that stuff. I also touched on game management with the ignore, acknowledge, warn, eject. Sort of four-step process for ejections. I think if we go through those and use some logic and our game experience to check those boxes before we make any actions, I think we're going to be in good shape. So I was impressed with all of our presenters, and I'm always appreciative of all the time they take to help our guys get better. So we touched a lot of business stuff, mm-hmm. which probably would be boring to the lay person out there watching, but you know, a lot of exciting perfect game updates and other leagues that are expanding and providing more games for our umpires to work. So it's all exciting stuff.
I think it's important that I think a lot of this stuff, you know, particularly with the game management, which is in itself a hard thing to teach, I think a lot of it comes as a function of being out there and being on the field and the experience of being in different situations during the course of all the games that everybody's doing.
I would agree with that, but in addition to that, you have to really take a thoughtful approach to game management and not allowing your emotions to get the best of you. You know, because we have guys that have been umpiring for 30 years that have the game management skills of a child,
right.
Because they allow their emotions to get the best of them mm-hmm. and overtake them. Instead of using their brain and their logic, they react based on emotion. So that's fairly normal for a player or a coach because they're in an emotional situation. Mm-hmm. Their win or loss or success or failure is hinged upon the outcome of a play.
Mm-hmm.
Yours is not,
right.
or mine is not,
right.
as an umpire. It doesn't matter who wins. It doesn't matter who was out and safe. Right. We are just observers of the game, and we have to handle things in a very matter-of-fact but still polite
mm-hmm.
Fashion.
Actually, I spent a few minutes at the podium delivering my standard uniform compliance pitch.
Always one of those popular segments.
I'm hoping to win an Emmy for that presentation.
Yeah, maybe if we get rid of the note cards, we might be able to pull it off. Speaking of the uniforms, we happen to have a couple here to present. This will be our standard primary black and gray, which to me makes... We've also updated the logo here, so we're going with our standard
yes.
merchandise attire, which
yeah.
You know the silhouette. You know
yes.
who the silhouette
yes.
is. If you want a trivia question for the people at home, the silhouette is?
The question for tonight is, who is the silhouette? We know who the silhouette is of the NBA logo. Who is the silhouette for the TSE logo?
Whoever gets that question, we'll give them a free TSEUA t-shirt. But here's our Pro Blue, which I think is a nice touch, and it really gets away from that sort of old school powder
yes.
blue. And it's a nice color scheme, and I really think the updated logo goes a long way rather than just, we used to have just the TSE logo on the breast.
Right.
So how lucky were we to have all sports officials? It looked like they brought the entire store into the dining hall there for our guys to basically shop as if it was a regular retail store, and allowed our guys to pick up uniforms that they ordered, you know, months in advance.
It was a very efficient operation. I was especially impressed because the people, the crew came down, Dennis Helmstetter, who's the owner and president of that company, came down with a couple of his assistants, and they came down with a huge trailer that was packed. You couldn't even fit a postage stamp in that trailer. That's how tight it was.
I think it really added a nice touch to the meeting, you know, where we had some breaks there, and pre-meeting and post-meeting guys picked up uniforms, were able to shop and you know, upgrade their attire and equipment. I think hopefully they'll come back next year, because I think it's a nice touch for the meeting.
One of the most important things that we do at our annual meeting is present several important awards. John, why don't you describe the award and who is this year's recipient?
Well, you know, most of the things we go over at the meeting are very important. You know, we don't waste a lot of time, but I think the most important thing in the grand scheme of life and morale building and sort of giving guys the pat on the back when they need it is these awards that we give out every year. And it went from one to two to three, and now we're at upwards of four awards. The newest award this year, which I was completely ecstatic that we got done with Perfect Game, Colleen Barth, Bob Barth, and Gary Wilson, who were at the meeting, is the Perfect Game Umpire of the Year, which went to our producer and technical editor, Nicholas Giaconetta, one of your biggest fans.
He is the glue.
We can be as entertaining as we want here. If somebody's not going to put this on film and edit it, the only two people that would be enjoying it would be me and you. The second award we give out is, again, very close to my heart, because if you remember in episode one, I talked about how important the South Jersey Men's Senior Baseball League was to our startup and growth. So Lou Marshall and Neil Hornahan from the SJMSBL, South Jersey Men's Senior Baseball League, pick an umpire of the year, and we present the South Jersey Men's Baseball League Umpire of the Year, which went to Kevin Jones, another fan favorite. Mm-hmm. Kevin's one of the greatest people you'll meet in the umpiring field.
I love Kevin Jones.
Just a great guy. Yeah. I know you guys can go out to dinner. but, yeah, Kevin's a great guy, and they couldn't think of anybody more deserving. Kevin is our first two-time award winner. He won the Brian Hoffman Memorial Award its first year, if you remember. So Kevin is certainly deserving of that award. Lou was on hand to present that award, as was Gary Wilson from Perfect Game. Right. So that was a nice presentation. Lou Marshall presented a very nice, I would say it was a gesture from Lou.
Yes.
As you know, Lou was very charitable and works with the North Camden Little League and presents a charity baseball game in late November where they do a food and toy drive for the children of North Camden. They collect a lot of food and a lot of toys for the Christmas time. And we always get a four-man crew, not two, not three, full four-man crew, just like the major leagues. Yeah. Everybody volunteers.
Right.
We generally get about 50, 60 umpires who volunteer to do this game. For last year was Don Crow was on the plate, a previous Brian Hoffman Award winner. And there was a child at the game who was left-handed. As you may know, Don is left-handed.
Yes.
And the player in question did not have a glove, so he was a little upset about that. Don went to his truck, got him a glove. And he gave this child his baseball glove and told him to keep it, respect the game. Right. And I don't know if I have it down verbatim, but he gave the child a very uplifting message. And, you know, I'm sure it lifted his spirits, the child. So when Lou got wind of it and heard about the situation, he got a custom-made glove for Don Crow with his name embroidered. And it was a beautiful glove. So it was a nice presentation to Don, and Don seemed very appreciative of it. And then the last one, we always save it for last. It's the most emotional, the most meaningful. It's the one I struggle with the most, the Brian Hoffman Memorial Award. We obviously lost Brian too soon due to his many illnesses and ultimately his battle that he lost with cancer. And that went to Mark Rowan, who is a fine example of everything Brian stood for. So ending our awards portion with that is really tough to bounce back with the emotions of it. And Darlene, Brian's wife, doing a phenomenal job in presenting sort of a tribute to him. She really did a great job of bringing us through the life of Brian, his evolution as an umpire, the relationship he and I had.
Right.
You know, I think in her, she referred to me as this hothead kid.
Anyway, the more Brian and John talked, the more I learned about this young hotheaded kid that Brian was so impressed with.
Which is exactly what I was at that time, and it's funny that that's the way she remembers it, because without his sort of
Mentoring
and, yeah. and calming influence, this thing yeah. would have went way yeah. off the rails.
Yeah, no, she was wonderful. She was she stole the show, but she was very. She's not an experienced speaker, obviously, but she was so beautiful and so emotional in her remarks that it was very nice. I really enjoyed it.
We tell her all the time, Brian's no longer with us, and he's no longer umpiring, obviously, but she is always a part of the TSEUA mm-hmm. family. She's welcome anytime, and right. she has a long-standing invitation to attend the annual meeting every single year. Right. To me, to present that award is what brings it all home.
I think it's a very nice thing that she does come, and hopefully she'll continue to come as long as we present the award in his name, and I could listen to that speech again.
This is the first year she decided to speak, and I'm yes. very glad she did with yeah. the encouragement of her family, yeah. And I encouraged her as well to speak, because I know a lot of umpires reached out to me after the meeting, and the common and most the most popular theme was that speech was extraordinary,
yes.
and people were moved to tears in that yes. room, and that is not exactly common in an umpiring meeting.
Yeah.
You know, for the first year, speaking of the meeting, this is the first year we had our full camera gear there, filmed the entire thing, so we put portions of it up on YouTube already, but the entire meeting will be up in the coming days, so guys will be able to recap, and guys who weren't there can watch it, so it's, to me, we're making some strides here. Bridgewater was the second of three open tryouts for, we say Perfect Game and Tri-State Elite Umpires Association, basically are one at this point in terms of the Northeast and us assigning baseball games to Perfect Game events. So we had a fantastic turnout in Allentown, as you know, you were mm-hmm. there. And then we went to Bridgewater and had a fantastic turnout. We had some really quality, mm-hmm. talented umpires there, which I was very impressed mm-hmm. with. And we had a group of guys in Bridgewater who desperately wanted to learn and were open to the criticism, or the, I say constructive criticism, despite their experience level. I mean, we had college umpires in the building that were getting torn to shreds. You were there to see
yeah.
that. And there wasn't an attitude given. There wasn't a pushback. It was, how can we get better? Let me take all of the information you have to mm-hmm. provide to me, and how can I put that into play to become a better umpire and better service
mm-hmm.
These teams and what I'm doing on the field. So that's what I was blown away most about with Bridgewater. And I really enjoyed my time there, and I got a lot of follow-ups, emails, guys yeah. looking for in-depth breakdowns of what they can improve.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, as an instructor, you can't ask for anything more than that. You know, to see all this footage, we would really be important to subscribe to our channel.
Mm-hmm.
This way, you can be updated whenever we release right. a new video, and all this mic'd up footage we're coming out with, to me, has been the response from our audience has been even more amplified
yeah.
with the mic'd up aspect of the behind the scenes mm-hmm. critiques and instructions. So I'm excited to pursue that avenue, and I think it'll be a big hit.
What we're producing here is turning out to be, and this is quite unexpected, I mean, it's becoming a very instructional and entertaining package.
And I call it edutainment.
And that's why I'm so hopeful that one of the major networks is going to step in one of these days and snatch us up.
Well, let me put a pin in that for a minute. Have you ever heard that phrase before? I just came up with it right now. Edutainment, we're going to combine the two of them, education, entertainment,
I like it.
Put them together, and we have one word, and that's what we're all about.
I think we should introduce that that word into the...
I already did.
The dictionary.
It's here, right there. Definition right below if you need it.
We're at the part of our podcast where each week we go over questions that have been sent in via email.
Or as Richard say, via email.
Through our website. First question, it was submitted by an umpire named Jason. His question is, I was really moved by Darlene Hoffman's speech. What's your best story about Brian Hoffman, John?
That is a tough question. I'm going to tell, he was such a good guy and a person who wanted to help. For the sake of entertainment value, I'm going to choose like something that highlights his foresight even in his ailing health. There's so many stories about him helping younger umpires, but it was really sad to watch a man that was such a terrific umpire on the field deteriorate as far as his health is concerned so rapidly. It was almost like overnight. Mm-hmm. I mean, we knew he was sick, But it was like overnight in terms of when he started to really deteriorate. And at that time, we started to have our conversations started to change from, you know, what's the problem with this guy, or, you know, short-term stuff, to him thinking long-term and trying to give me advice for when he would no longer be here. And that was hard to handle in the moment, and is even difficult to talk to now. But I remember the foresight he had, and he said to me, and this was probably 10 days before he passed, and he said, "I'm not going to be here for it, but you have everything it takes to take over umpiring in South Jersey." And, you know, in that moment, my mind was, there's no shot. You know, he's just saying something nice to me. But to many people would agree, we have now taken over South Jersey umpiring. Mm-hmm. And that's a testament to everything he taught me, and the sort of long-term approach to handling situations. And, you know, like he was a big proponent of the 24-hour rule. Don't act on something the same day it happened. Mm-hmm. Don't make an emotional decision that you might regret the next day. Mm-hmm. You know, let cooler heads prevail. Things like that have really served me well, because that was really a weakness of mine when I was 22, 23, 24 years old. So just the foresight of that still gives me the chills of hearing him say that back then. So
our second question comes from an umpire named Derek. His question is this: I watched the mic'd up video from Bridgewater. I heard so many bleeps.
The egregious shit is where we get. When is this shit gonna bite pain in the ass? I'm like, don't move.
Why do you curse so much,
John? Listen, I apologize. I apologize in advance.
We're gonna have to put in what they call a 7-second delay.
I don't curse on the podcast. I really try to keep it PG. But when I'm all hyped up in the moment, I was talking about the intensity of the training. I have a flaw in when I get passionate about something and start getting going, the expletives just start to roll out. So, I mean, if there was, I can't even say that. If there was children there, they still might come out. So I really don't know. If it offends you, maybe it's not the podcast or the YouTube channel for you, but I don't mean any harm by it. It's really like more of a point of emphasis than an insult. You know, when bleep, you know, let's bleep and go or whatever. It's more of a point of emphasis or a motivational tool.
It's emotional.
It is emotion. Yeah. And so I think it goes to show, whether you like it or not, I'm pretty passionate about what we're doing here.
Question number three comes from an umpire named Tony. Tony describes a situation. We have runners on first and second. The pitcher goes to deliver the pitch, but as he's doing so, the batter puts his right hand up and verbally says time as he steps out of the box. The pitcher stopped and never delivered the pitch. Is this considered a balk?
Not quite as wacky as our standard Scanzano questions. The answer is no, it is not a balk. The reason it's not a balk is because what caused the pitcher to stop his motion? The batter exiting the batter's box caused the pitcher to stop his motion. The offense cannot cause a balk. So, by rule, that would be nothing. The way to umpire this play is not to simply stay behind the catcher and just become a spectator. We have to really get out from behind the plate, and when the pitcher stops his motion, we do have to call time. And we have to really sell the fact that this is nothing. We have to literally say, that's nothing. Speaking of Brian Hoffman, the fact that that's even a call was taught to me by him. The phrase, that's nothing, is a call.
Mm-hmm.
So if you just sort of hang behind the catcher and allow this to play out, coaches are going to start to get anxious coming out of the dugout thinking this has to be a penalty on one side or the other.
Mm-hmm.
We have to really get out there and sell the fact that this is nothing. We reset and we continue to play.
Okay.
Nothing.
That's a good question, by the way, that Tony...
Nice job, Tony.
Okay, our final question is from an umpire named Robert. He says, or his question is, you mentioned several times in the Bridgewater video that you wanted the umpires to have a natural timing over an artificial timing. John, what is the difference?
The difference between artificial and natural timing is, natural timing is tracking the ball all the way into the glove when you're behind the plate, specifically. If you track the ball all the way into the mitt and let the mitt stop moving, and then you decide whether the ball is a ball or strike, and then after that you render your decision, your timing will be perfect naturally. Artificial timing is saying to yourself, I'm going to wait X amount of seconds before I make a call. Now, if you have artificial timing, like I just said, where you wait X amount of seconds before you make your call, you may appease an instructor like me, because it's hard to tell if it's artificial or natural as an onlooker. But the accuracy of your calls will not improve, because you're not using that time to evaluate the pitch longer. You're just using that time to delay your call. When you have natural timing, you're gathering more evidence. You're watching the path of the baseball. You're watching the glove movement of the catcher. You're now able to use the reference points on the catcher to see if the ball remains in the strike zone or not. So if you add that all together, the guy that has natural timing is going to be more accurate with his calls, and the guy with artificial timing is going to have less accuracy with his calls, although they may look very similar to someone who's watching. So I try to caution these guys. Don't get in the habit of trying to appease me by being slower, but also not tracking the ball. Yeah. We got to track the pitch, and on the bases it becomes tracking the baseball coming off the bag and waiting for voluntary release. But that's all natural timing. Artificial timing is something that might fool an instructor from getting on your case, but it will not help the accuracy of your calls. So artificial timing is a real danger to guys that are really trying to fix the timing issue.
Which now brings us to our favorite segment of the week.
Hello, my name is Mike Scanzano, Scanzano Sports, and this is our question of the week.
The Scanzano Sports Center is a 40,000 square foot indoor sports facility conveniently located in Cherry Hill, New Jersey. Scanzano Sports is home to Combat Baseball, one of the fastest growing travel baseball programs in the tri-state area. Whether you are looking for specialized instruction, a premier facility to work out in, or to try their brand new pitching laboratory, Scanzano Sports has you covered. To visit them on the web, please visit scanzanosports.com.
A routine ground ball is hit to the shortstop. The shortstop bobbles the baseball and then throws to first base. The runner is through the bag by the time the ball arrives, but he never touched first base. Is the runner out or safe?
Tricky.
Very tricky.
You want to put your input on this one, or you want me to take it?
No, I want to defer to you.
All right, as we have for the previous four episodes. This is tricky, although it's very uncommon. Another wacky question. I'm going to preface it with get ready for your ejections. That's getting old. Maybe we can get we'll put the disclaimer at the bottom. Be prepared to eject. Okay, here's the deal with this question. The runner beats the ball. That's what we're saying here. I try to eliminate all the noise like I was doing with Stanton, but we're a different caliber of host, so we're going to explain it again. If the runner beat the ball in this situation, routine ground ball to shortstop, the runner beat the ball.
Yes.
But he never touched first base.
Right.
I just want to make sure I understand this correctly. The fact that the runner beat the ball means you have to call him safe.
Yes.
Okay? You have to rule him safe because he beat the baseball. The only way this runner could be out is after you signal him safe because he did beat the baseball. The defensive team would have to then appeal that he missed first base, and they would have to do that before he returned to first base. So if he ran through the bag, stopped, turned around and walked back and stood on first base, and they said, hey, he missed first base. Guess what? Too late.
Right.
You have to do it either by tagging him or touching first base and clearly indicating to the umpire that you are appealing the fact that he missed first base. Mm-hmm. Now, if this was a tag play at another bag and he missed the bag, you would not have to make a call. The fact that this is a force out means you have to rule on the play because he either beat the throw or he didn't. Keep in mind, you're not saying he touched first base. Mm-hmm. You're saying he beat the ball to the spot where first base would be. Mm-hmm. So if I go beyond first base before the ball arrives, did I beat the baseball?
Yes.
Yes, I did. He's safe. Unless they appeal before he retouches. Mm-hmm. So that's the answer. Good question. Get ready for ejections.
Get out my pad.
And you're going to have to submit an ejection report. If you remember earlier in the podcast, we asked a very special trivia question about who is the silhouette in the TSEUA logo. In order to win the prize and correctly answer, you will have to subscribe to our channel right below and submit your answer in the comment section. If we end up with multiple winners, because it is a very popular figure, we could get multiple correct answers. We will choose one of the correct answers at random. I know you were very concerned about the size of the winner, and we'll get that information once we announce the winner, and we will get your TSEUA t-shirt right out to you.
It's a nice gift, and I think what they should do in addition to that is they should submit their size for the t-shirt.
Well, why don't we take care of that once they win?
Okay.
All right, is that fair?
Right. We'll just contact the winner and advise them that they've been the...
We can handle it that way, but I wanted to use our last 30 seconds just to drive home the fact that I'm very appreciative that you're here. And last week, I didn't really enjoy myself much, and it was difficult to do without you. And like I said, I'm Jordan, you're Pippin, and I felt like I was working last week with Speedy Claxton. So,
well, we're both Jordan and Pippin are both in the Hall of Fame, and I was sorry I couldn't make it. I had other things I had to deal with.
I think Speedy Claxton is in the
Speedy Claxton.
he's in the High School Hall of Fame over at Rosemont High. Yeah. So but, either way, I told Stanton if everybody else under the sun is unavailable, he's always welcome back. And so it's good to have you back, and I want to thank everybody for watching episode 5 of Behind the Mask. We'll be back next week with episode 6.
Part named Jason.
All right, let's take it from the top.
Okay.
Can't stop.
Yeah.